Good morning. So welcome to the session. In the last three classes, we saw a number of concepts in vector algebra and vector calculus. And today's class, I have reserved it only to solve numerical problems. Okay? And you will find similar kinds of problems throughout the course. So let's do some problems. And dear students, please flip your books and see to it that you are with me as I go through the problems. Okay, fine. So in the last class also we saw some examples. So now let's proceed. Calculate the divergence of D at the point specified if D is given by 1 by z square into 10 xyz ax plus 5 x squared z ay plus 2z cubed minus 5 x squared y az. So this is the function of the vector field, and I want you to evaluate the divergence at point P minus 2, 3, 5. Okay, we are lucky because this is in Cartesian coordinates, and in Cartesian coordinates we know what is the divergence, right? What is it? Dou ax by dou x plus dou ay by dou y plus dou az by dou z. So now let me take the x component. This is the x component. So the derivative of this with respect to x, what do you get? You get 1 by z 10 y. So this z square and z will cancel. You will get 1 by z 10 y. Then the derivative of this term with respect to y. There is no y here, so this will be 0. Okay, and the derivative of this term with respect to z. So 2z cubed by z square will give me 2z. The derivative of that is 2. And here I have 1 by z square and this minus 5x squared y. And I have to actually take the derivative of 1 by z square, because when I take the partial differentiation of this with respect to z, x and y will be constants. So actually I need to evaluate minus 5 z squared x squared y by z squared, take the derivative with respect to z, which works out to be 10 x squared y by z cubed. Clear? So this is the divergence. This is the divergence. Recollect, the divergence is a star quantity. Clear? Now the divergence is actually a function. I'm having here y and x and z. So it will be, I can evaluate it at any given the values of and z. So I need to evaluate it at P minus 2, 3, 5. So I substitute for x as minus 2, y as 3, z as 5, and this function points. Divergence is the operator del taken with respect to a vector. Okay, so you can have the divergence. The divergence is a scalar and you can at a space. This is clear. Next. Okay. Check if the field is constant. So if a vector field, the divergence is zero, it is called as a solenoidal field. And curl is zero, it's called as a conservative or an irrotate. Two fields when you do it, basically conservative and magnetic fields are solenoid. They don't have a divergence. Electric fields don't have a curl. Okay. That's why it is important for you to know this. So function f, the unit vectors use similar I, because some do use ijk instead of ax, ay, az, and you should not get confused about what it is. You don't have this kind of a problem coordinate systems, but coordinates very commonly. This is, and I whether it will fine. Of f, so how do we take the curl? It is the determinant, the first row of the determinant vectors I, j, a, x, a, y, a, where you want to, and the second line is dou by dou y, dou on the three x component of the vector field. Now you have to evaluate this determinant. Easy, right? Let me just do one for you. This it is I into I dou y minus 2xyz. Okay, and then I have minus dou by dou z of 8xyz cubed by z squared. So you just evaluate and you will find the determinant to be z. Hence we can conclude that this function f is a vector function field is conserved, its curl. So you add the vector curl is zero at all. So you see function itself zero is not that at one point in curl becomes zero. No, function itself greater. So what use it to this is Now today we saw different coordinate systems, cylindrical coordinate and spherical coordinates. So let me refresh your memory. Cylindrical coordinates, every point is the intersection of three surfaces. One surface is a cylinder specified by its radius, and it's important that the axis of the cylinder is the z-axis. Another surface is a plane which makes an angle phi with the x-axis, and the third surface is the z equal to constant plane, that is a plane parallel to the yz plane. Okay, so now what I want you to do is, I have given you a vector in Cartesian coordinate and I want you to transform it into cylindrical coordinates at a point p 10 minus 8 and 6. Clear? Now please understand two things. Every point in space, okay, every point in space has three coordinates. Okay, these three coordinates are x, y, z in Cartesian, and it is rho phi z in cylindrical and r theta phi in spherical. Okay, so every point itself you can transform from one coordinate system to other coordinate system. Every point. Next, every vector also can be transformed from one point to another, from one coordinate system to another coordinate system. So kindly understand the difference between the two. Okay, so fine. Now I want to transform this vector to cylindrical coordinates. So what do we do? I told you, you take the dot product of the vector with the unit vector to get to get, transform it along the component. So A, sorry, this is A row. A row will be, A row will be A, that is a vector A dot the unit vector along the row direction. So what will you get? You will get 10 AX dot A row minus 8 AY dot A row minus 6 AZ dot A row. So that's the function you get. Now AZ dot A row is 0 because AZ and A row are orthogonal. Okay, 90 degrees you have between these two unit vectors. So this term becomes 0. So what is the radial component? It is 10 cos phi minus 8 sin phi plus 0. Now what is phi? So I want, this is a function. Okay, this is A row, this is the function. So now I want to evaluate it at a particular point, and that point is P10 minus 8, 6. So I transform this point to cylindrical coordinates. I get phi is tan inverse of y by x, that is tan inverse of minus 8 by 10. Now be careful whenever you use your calculator, because your calculators will give you the angle between 0 to 180 degrees. Okay, that is in the first and second quadrant. So now you should know in which quadrant is the angle. Okay, your calculator doesn't give you a 360 degree angle. So here you just, some calculators do give, but you be careful. So here y is negative, okay, and x is positive. So which quadrant is that? It is a fourth quadrant, right? Y is negative and x is positive, so it is the fourth quadrant. And fourth quadrant, the angles lie between 0 to minus 90 degrees, right? I'm stressing this point because, you know, different calculators give the angles differently. So once you know the quadrant, you can easily fix up the angle. So tan inverse of minus 8 by 10 is minus 36.659 degrees. So the radial component, I just substitute for this phi, is this 10 into cos of this minus 8 into sine of this, which works out to 12.804. okay, next I need to find the phi component. So that is A dot A phi. Here this is nothing but the unit vector along phi. So that is 10 AX dot A phi minus 8 AY dot A phi minus 6 AZ dot A phi. Now this is 0 because again the z axis, unit vector along z and unit vector along phi are orthogonal at a point, and therefore this is 0. And AX dot A phi is minus sine phi, and AY dot A phi is cos phi. So this becomes 0. Okay, for the, we have already evaluated phi. So for the given values of, for the value of phi, that is minus 36 something, this is 0. And what is AZ? AZ is our good old, see, it is the same thing. You don't have to do any calculation. It is minus 6 AZ. It is the same. Therefore, this is AZ dot AZ is 1. So sorry, this is not 6. This is minus 6. Therefore, A is 12.804 A row minus 6. This is not a plus. Please correct it. It's a minus. Minus 6 AZ in cylindrical coordinates. So we did two things here. We got the coordinates of a point in Cartesian coordinate to be transformed it into cylindrical coordinates, and we could also transform a vector into symmetrical, into cylindrical coordinate systems. Okay, so now let's take another example. So here I want to transform from Cartesian to spherical. Okay, so what are the three surfaces in a spherical system? The first surface is a sphere passing through the point, and the radius of the sphere is specified from the origin. So that means it's a sphere centered at the origin and passing through the point under question. Next, second surface is a cone which makes an angle theta. It's a conical surface which makes an angle theta with the z axis and passes through the point under question. And the third one is a plane which makes an angle phi with the x axis. So this is same as this angle phi is the same as in the cylindrical coordinates. So now I want you to transform a simple vector f equal to 10 ax into spherical coordinates at p minus 3, 2, 4. So this is the point under consideration now. So the radial component is f dot ar. Ar is the unit vector along the radial component. So that is 10 ax dot ar, and that is 10 sine theta cos phi. You remember yesterday I told you how important is it for you to know all the conversion equations. You must memorize that to use it, right? Unless you know you have an open book exam where you can take the equations to class, otherwise you have to somehow remember it. So ax dot ar is sine theta cos phi. Okay, so my radial component in the spherical coordinate system is 10 sine theta cos phi. So I need to find out what is theta and what is phi. So phi is same as before, tan inverse of y by x. So now you here you see y is positive and x is negative. See, why I'm telling you is in the previous case this was negative and this was positive, so you will get tan inverse of a negative number, and here also you're getting tan inverse of a negative number, but that was in the fourth quadrant, whereas this, where y is positive and x is negative, is in the second quadrant. So the angle is 146.31 degrees. If you don't do this angle correctly, your sine theta cos phi will be wrong. Okay, and theta, this is phi, theta is given by cos inverse of z by root of r. R is root of x square plus y square plus z square. Okay, so this works out to be 42.031. So now that I have phi and theta, I can substitute them here and evaluate fr. Fr is 10 into sine of this into cos of phi, which gives me minus 5.5702. I have got one component in the spherical coordinate system. Now f theta is f dot a theta, where a theta is the unit vector along the conical surface passing through the point P under consideration. So f is what? Only 10 ax. So I have 10 ax dot a theta, and ax dot a theta is cos theta cos phi. I have already found out what is theta and what is phi. So it is minus, it works out to minus 6.18. And f phi is f dot a phi, and that is equal to 10 ax dot a phi, and that is equal to 10 ax dot a phi is minus sine phi, and that is minus 5.547. therefore the vector f is equal to minus 5.702 ar minus 6.18 a theta minus 5.547 a phi. I have used a lot of formula here. First is convert the point from Cartesian to spherical, and next to find the individual components, I take the dot product along the unit vector and then evaluate the individual components. Okay, and I have also used the formula of ax dot a theta, ax dot a phi, and so on. So those tables are, again I stress, very very important, right? So now we consider two examples wherein I converted from Cartesian to cylindrical and Cartesian to spherical. Now let's do this. I'm given a scalar function v. V is defined by rho z sin phi plus z squared cos squared phi plus rho squared. Now by looking at the function, you should be able to make out whether it is in Cartesian coordinate or cylindrical coordinate or spherical coordinate. Now the presence of phi rho z clearly indicates that it is in cylindrical coordinates. Sometimes it may not be specified. By looking at it, you should know. You should identify the coordinate system used. Now I have a scalar function. So what can you determine for any scalar function? Can you determine divergence? No. Can you determine curl? No. You can determine the gradient. So the gradient is defined for a scalar function or for a scalar field. Right? And yesterday, when I did cylindrical and spherical coordinates, I gave you the equations for the gradient, the divergence and the curl in all the three coordinate systems. But in the problems, wherever necessary, I have put it again. So the gradient of a scalar function V in cylindrical coordinates is given by dou V by dou rho A rho plus 1 by rho dou V by A phi A phi plus dou V by dou Z A Z. Clear? So what is V? V is this function. I have to take the derivative with respect to rho. So I get a z sin phi here. And the derivative of this with respect to rho is 0. And the derivative of this with respect to rho is 2 rho. So I get z sin phi plus 2 rho A rho. Next, 1 by rho. I need to take the derivative with respect to phi. Here it would be rho z cos phi, and this would be z squared 2 cos phi sin phi, which is nothing but sin 2 phi, and the derivative of this with respect to phi is 0, right? Then derivative of this with respect to z is rho sin phi, that's what I have here. Derivative of this with respect to z is 2 z cos squared phi. Derivative of this with respect to z is 0. So I have this. I have the gradient. Very simple. If you remember the formula, it is simple derivative. Okay. Now again, let's recap. The gradient is the operator del operated on a scalar function. And the gradient itself is a vector quantity. Okay. Where do I use it? The electric field intensity is the negative of the gradient of the potential. So that's where you are going to use it. The divergence of E has a particular meaning. The curl of E is 0. You will find out the divergence of B. B is the magnetic field. The curl of B. So all these things you are going to use, and that's why we are working out all these problems. Okay? Fine. So this was how to evaluate a gradient in cylindrical coordinate. Now you, if given any point rho z phi, you can easily evaluate the gradient at that particular point. I have evaluated the gradient function. Now this class I am going to take up two simple theorems which again we will be using in the course. So we saw what is a divergence. We saw it mathematically, right? In all the three coordinate systems. Now I also gave you a physical visual effect for the divergence. So if I have a point, how does a field, the vector field, diverge from that particular point? Okay. So the other definition for divergence is the divergence of a vector A at any point P is the outward flow of flux. Outward flux is the integral of the vector with respect to the surface area. That means I have a surface, so there is some vector field flowing out, so that is the outward flow. Okay, so when you have a closed surface, when I have a closed surface, I told you a closed surface encloses a volume. Right. So now you have an outward normal and an inward normal. So we are taking the outward flow. Okay. So the flux means the integral of the vector with the surface. So the divergence at any point is the outward flow of flux per unit volume as the volume shrinks about P. Okay, so you just think of a water gushing out from a closed surface, some liquid gushing out. So the velocity of the liquid could be the vector quantity you are interested in. So how much of it will gush out at a particular point? I'm just trying to give you some analogy. So the divergence is limit of, as the volume shrinks, so as delta volume tends to zero, the flux, this is called as the flux of a vector. So now you see here, I have not just used the integral symbol, I have put a circle around it, which means that you are considering a closed surface. You're considering a closed surface. Clear? So that is the meaning of this circle, closed. A dot ds. A is the vector and ds is the differential surface area of the closed surface per unit volume. So this is called as the flux of the vector, any vector, right? Any vector. This is the flux of the vector, and so the flux of the vector per unit volume as the volume tends to zero. This is the mathematical definition of divergence. Now we have a divergence theorem based on this. The divergence theorem states that the total outward flux of a vector field A through the closed surface S is same as the volume integral of the divergence of A. Okay, what does it say? The total flux, if you take the entire surface, the total flux out of the surface is same as, closed surfaces enclose a volume, it's same as the volume integral of the divergence. Okay, if I state the mathematical counterpart, you will easily understand. So you just see here, this is the total flux passing out through the entire closed surface. Right, this is the closed. What does this S mean? This is the surface under consideration. The circle is a closed surface. This is the vector. This is the total flux of the vector crossing the surface A. This is equal to the integral of the divergence over the entire volume. Are you getting it? Integral of the divergence over the entire volume. Now, why such a theorem? You just see here, on this side I have a surface integral. So in any surface integral you have two variables. So in simple Cartesian coordinate, xy will vary or xz will vary or yz will vary if you take simple surfaces, but two coordinates will vary. And in a volume integral, I'll have it's a triple integral. Volume integral is actually a triple integral, whereas surface integral is a double integral. So I am equating a double integral to a triple integral. Is it clear? Okay. Next, the curl of A is a vector. Now we are defining the curl. The curl of A is a vector whose magnitude is the maximum circulation of A per unit area as the area tends to zero, and whose direction is the normal direction of the area when the area is oriented to make circulation maximum. So the curl of A is limit of delta S tending to zero as the area shrinks of what? The circulation. Circulation is defined as the integral of A dot dl. Right, now again I have put a surface circle here. A circle means what? Closed. Now you see, if I have an open line, this is a line, right? An open line does not enclose any surface. But if I have a closed line, this is also a line, but the line is closed, then the closed line can enclose a surface. Right, just like an open surface cannot enclose a volume, but a closed surface can enclose a volume. So the curl of A is mathematically defined as limit of delta S tending to zero of the closed line integral of A dot dl per unit area, which is maximum in the normal direction to the surface. Now Just like we had divergence theorem, we have another theorem called as the Stokes theorem, which states that the circulation of a vector field A about a closed path L, L is a closed path, is equal to the surface integral of the curl of A over the open surface S bounded by L, provided A and curl of A are continuous on the surface. Remember, it is a differential. Curl and divergence and gradient are all differentials, and in mathematics you would have studied discontinuous functions. So discontinuous functions cannot be differentiated at some points. So then you cannot evaluate the divergence and curl at those points. So what Stokes' theorem says is the integral of A dot dl, this is the total circulation of the vector A around the closed line L, is equal to the surface integral of the curl of A over the surface. So line integral is a single integral and surface integral is a double integral. So I am now giving you a theorem which can transform a line integral to a surface integral. The divergence theorem we saw, we could transform a surface integral into a volume integral. Okay, so now let's get on with some more numericals. So we studied two new things today, the divergence theorem and the Stokes theorem. Okay, now given the vector Q, rho sin phi A rho plus rho squared Z A phi plus Z cos phi A Z, determine the divergence of Q. Alright, now quickly, which coordinate system is this? Yes, cylindrical coordinates, because I have rho, phi and Z. Fine, the divergence of any vector in cylindrical coordinate is given by this. So I have here, you see, 1 by rho, dou by dou rho, rho, q rho. What is q rho? Q rho is the component of q along the vector a rho, that is rho sine phi. And then 1 by rho, dou by dou phi, q phi. Q phi is the component along a phi. And dou by dou z of q z. Right, so now what is q rho? Q rho is rho sin phi, and q phi is rho squared z, and q z is rho z cos phi. So I just put all that and I evaluate the integrals. Simple dou by dou rho of rho squared sin phi would be 2 rho sin phi, so the rho and rho gets cancelled and it is 2 sin phi. Okay, plus there is no phi term here, so this differential will be equal to 0, and dou by dou z of this is cos phi, so the divergence is simply 2 sin phi plus cos phi. So this is a function, and given a point P, you can find out what is phi, tan inverse of y by x, and determine what is the divergence at that particular point. Okay, and again I want to draw your attention, the divergence is a scalar quantity, it's a number. Okay, okay, now this is a relatively simple problem. Determine the divergence of A at point 1, -2, 3 if A is given by yz ax plus 4xy ay plus y az. So we are back to Cartesian coordinates, the simplest. So the divergence is simply dou ax by dou x plus dou ay by dou y plus dou az by dou z. Right? And what is ax? The x component. There is a component along ax. It is yz. And dou y is the component along yay, which is 4xy. And az is component along az, which is y. So this has no z x, so this is 0. This differential with respect to y is 4x. This has no z, so it is 0. So the divergence of A is simply 4x. Okay, now I want you to evaluate at 1, -2, 3. So here x is 1, so it is simply 4. Okay, so given any vector, the divergence will be a function and that function can be evaluated at specific points. Okay, so given a is y minus 1 ax plus 2x ay, so again we are in Cartesian coordinates. Determine the vector a at point 2, 2, 1 and the scalar projection of a on b, where b is equal to 5ax minus ay plus 2az. Right? So the first one is simple. I want you to evaluate a at this point. Simply substitute the values of x, y and z. So you get ax plus 4ay. That is simple. Now, I have vector a and I have vector b. Okay. Now, whatever, this is just illustrative. This is only illustrative. It doesn't correspond to these vectors. So I have vector a and I have vector b. What is the meaning of projection of a on b? This. So this will be the projection of a on b. So what is it? I told you, the dot product of any vector along the unit vector will give you the projection of the vector along the unit vector. So if I want the projection of a along b, I have to take the dot product of a with the unit vector along b. Clear? And what is a unit vector along b? It is nothing but b by magnitude of b. So the projection of a on b, I get a dot b by magnitude of b, right? And what is a dot b? Very simple, you only have to multiply the corresponding quantities. Yeah, this is a at that point. Okay, so it will be 1 into 5, 4 into minus 1 plus 2 into 0. This is 2, this is 0. So a dot b by root of magnitude of b. Magnitude of b is root of 5 squared plus 1 squared plus 2 squared. So I get 1 by root 30. So the scalar projection of a on b is 1 by root 30. Okay. Next. Given the two points a, x, y, z are given, and b is what? R equal to 4, theta is equal to 25 degrees and phi equal to 120 degrees. Find the spherical coordinates of A and Cartesian coordinates of B. So we are back to our coordinate systems. Fine. Simple. All these are pretty simple. You only have to know the formula to use. Right? And actually I would suggest, the teachers, the faculty, at least in the tests, I think you should not make the students memorize the formula. You can as well give a sheet with the formula for the tests. And maybe it can be even done in the main exam. Fine. So, converting to spherical coordinates. So, from Cartesian to spherical, r is given by root of x squared plus y squared plus z squared. So, that is 3.7416. And theta, that is the angle of the cone, the angle which the cone makes with the z axis, is given by tan inverse root of x squared plus y squared by z. So that is 105.5 degrees. And phi is tan inverse of y by x. So both are positive, so it's in the first quadrant. It is 56.31 degrees. So this is the point A in spherical coordinates. Clear? The point is the same. It's only the way I represent it which is different. Next, I have B. So now I must convert from spherical to Cartesian. Spherical to Cartesian. So X is given by R sine theta cos phi. All are given. Simply you just have to apply the formula. Y is R sine theta sine phi and Z is R cos theta. So I have in Cartesian system, I have the point B given by minus 0.845 AX plus 1.464 AY plus 3.625 AZ. Next, Again, this is the mixed coordinates. So given A in Cartesian and B in cylindrical, determine the distance from A to B. So very simple, what I will do, I will convert this B into Cartesian coordinates. So when I convert B into Cartesian coordinates, I get the x as 2.57, y is minus 3.06 and z is 2. And I want the distance from A to B. So I told you it is the destination minus the source, or the ending point minus the starting point. So this is what I get. The magnitude is root of all this is 6.79. That's the distance between A and B. If it is, if you have to show it as a vector, it would be 2.57 minus 2ax plus minus 6.06ay plus 3az. That's the vector from A to B. Next we'll see what we have. Okay, now again I have a field, a vector field F given by 6xi. I told you ijk are nothing but ax, ay, az, you are familiar with it in maths, plus 2y minus y squared j plus 6z minus x cubed k. Determine if the field is conservative. So what do you do to check whether a field is conservative? You have to take its curl, right? So curl, I have I, J, K, or A, X, A, Y, A, Z, dou by dou X, dou by dou Y, dou by dou Z, and the X component, the Y component, and the Z component. So you have to evaluate this determinant, right? So when I do all the exercise of taking the derivatives, this determinant works out to be 3X squared J, or 3X squared A, Y. So is this field conservative? No. Okay, so it's not a conservative field because the curl is not equal to 0. That should be your answer. Okay, verify whether this field is solenoidal and irrotational. Irrotational means conservative, solenoidal means the divergence should be 0. So I evaluate the divergence, the divergence happens to be 0, therefore this field is solenoidal. Then I take the curl also happens to be 0, hence it is also irrotational. So this field is both solenoidal and irrotational. Now the last problem. Using, this is just to show you how we'll use divergence theorem. Using divergence theorem, evaluate integral of A dot ds, where A is given by this vector and S is the surface of the cube bounded by the plane x equal to 0, x equal to 1, y equal to 0, y equal to 1, and z equal to 0, z equal to 1. So I have a cube, right? So the cube is bound between 0 and 1, 0 and 1, and 0 and 1 on all the three axes. So I get a cube, 1 by 1 by 1 cube. And I have a vector A. So I want you to use the divergence theorem and evaluate it. So now what does the divergence theorem say? Integral of A dot ds is equal to integral over the volume of the divergence of A. Okay. So first let me evaluate the divergence of A. Right. I need dou by dou x of ax. 2xy, when I differentiate with respect to x, I get 2y. And y squared, when I differentiate with respect to y, I get 2y. And 4yz, when I differentiate with respect to z, I get 4y. Therefore, the divergence is 8y. Clear? Now, how do I have to evaluate this. I have to evaluate this. So, the divergence is divergence of A, this is 4y, and what is the volume? dv dx, sorry, it is 8y, and volume is dx dy dz, and what are my limits of the three coordinates? 0 1 0 1 0 1 x y z, all from 0 to 1, right? So you see, this is what we call as a triple integral. Three variables are there with limits, that's called as a triple integral. How do you evaluate it? Evaluate it taking one variable at a time. One variable at a time. So first let me keep y and z as constants. Okay, or let me evaluate it with respect to z. So if I integrate this with respect to z, it will be just 1 dz, which is z. So I'll get 8yz to be evaluated from 0 to 1 dx dy. So I get 8y dx dy. Next, I differentiate this, sorry, I integrate it with respect to y. So when I integrate this with respect to y, I'll get 8y squared by 2, where y varies from 0 to 1 dx. So when I evaluate this, I get 4, then 4 integral dx from 0 to 1, which is 4x, which I get 4. Clear? So whenever you have a triple integral, you please integrate it one at a time, taking one variable at a time. So first I have integrated with respect to z, then I have integrated with respect to y, and then I have integrated with respect to x, and then you evaluate. So this is how the divergence theorem is applied. So now with this I close. So now I just want to spend a couple of minutes telling you the significance of what we have learned. Okay, so in this course you're going to learn about electric fields. So electric fields are caused by charges, okay, positive and negative charges. So now these charges can have different types of configurations. It can be a point charge, where there is a charge of some magnitude at a particular point. It can be a line charge. I can have a wire which is charged. It can be a surface charge, so I can have a rectangular or any kind of a surface which is charged. It can be a volume charge. I can have a metallic ball and the ball is entirely charged. So I have different charge configurations. Okay, so the electric field is evaluated for different kinds of charges. Now the electric field has some properties and it is related to some other parameters. So for different charge configurations, we will evaluate the electric fields and see how they are going to vary, and that is where all these concepts of gradient, divergence, etc. is going to help us. And with respect to electric field, we are very much concerned about potential, which we normally loosely call as the voltage. So how is the electric field related to the voltage? Right, and so all these things will constitute the next two units. Next we see about magnetic fields. Now a magnetic field is created in the presence of current. So whenever there is a current, you have magnetic fields. So we would essentially be studying some current configurations. So when it comes to current, most often we will be talking of conductors, line current. That means current flowing through a line and its magnetic field. And sometimes we do examples of surface current. And where would you say have an example of a surface current? A conductor where the current flows on the surface. So that typically that example could be on your eddy currents. Eddy currents flow on the surface. So we have surface currents. And volume current density, typically if you have a big conductor, right, you have a fat conductor, so it has a specific area of cross section and the current is flowing through it, you can treat it like a volume current. So these are the current configurations you will be studying, and we would be trying to evaluate the magnetic fields because of this. Now we saw about conservative field and irrotational fields and so on. So can you just have an arbitrarily electric field? What do I mean by that? Supposing I just give you an electric field. I say E is equal to 4xy ax plus some xy x squared yz ay plus z cubed minus 3ax az. Is it possible for you to have any configuration in the world which will give you that particular field? Right, so there we will be making use of the concepts of the conservativeness of the fields, electric fields and magnetic fields. So in the first four units you would be talking only of static fields. Static fields means fields which do not change with time, they are not functions of time, so those are all static fields. So in the last unit, we start talking of waves. So what happens when I have an electric field which is time varying? Will it create a magnetic field? And if it creates a magnetic field, what happens? And how do these two behave together? How is a wave created, electromagnetic wave created, and so on? So let me tell you one thing. There are some forces we have in the universe. So you have the Coulomb's force, the force of attraction, and you have a strong nuclear force. So you see, if you take the nucleus of an atom, you have protons there which are positively charged, and they're so close together, right? And so if you see normally, what happens? It should just explode because of force of repulsion, right? But nucleus of atoms are very stable. So that means what happened to the Coulomb's force? Because Coulomb force of like charges, right, is repulsive. So when I have two protons which are very close together, they must explode, just explode. What is happening there? So I have a strong nuclear force there. And then I have the gravitational force. And then I have the electromagnetic force. So most of the forces you see in nature, they all fall under electromagnetic forces. And all the kind of waves we have, you know, including the visual optic spectrum, the infrared, ultraviolet, and the invisible X-rays, all these, they all form the electromagnetic wave spectrum. So the study of the electromagnetic wave is very, very important. So with this session, I'm closing on the mathematical part of it, and please, I request all of you to brush up whatever we have done so that you can closely follow the rest of the numericals which we will be doing. Thank you.